Hello everyone, and very good evening or good afternoon or good morning, based on where you are located. We are very happy to have you all as a part of this event, the third of its kind, look forward to have a very productive session. We have speakers, eminent scholars and social workers, to be part of this session.
I think it's time for the Finn video, then we go to the panel.
Hi, I'm Shyama Ramani, the founder of Friend in Need India Trust, or Finn. Finn was created in the aftermath of the Asian tsunami of 2004. It emerged out of adopting a village to make sure that everyone in the village had access to life's essentials. Over time, it first started focusing on sanitation. But then I didn't know about World Toilet Day till I joined the United Nations University. I'm an academic, an economist, but still, I find that we have always celebrated toilets, safe toilets, because that is the way to get this behavioral change from open defecation to usage of toilets. To celebrate the toilet, in fact, our first was the toilet beauty contest. How do you get men in a village to use toilets when they prefer the beach? So we created a beauty contest with nice rewards, but the rule was that the men should also use the toilets for the families to participate. This led to many families, many men in the village experimenting with toilet usage and finding it's not so bad after all. Then over time, it was discovered that many of these toilet structures were not climate resilient, and they were not made out of good quality, and they had many design defects. So another of our toilet celebrations was innovation contest, and we discovered that rural masons in rural India, they actually learn through doing, and many of them don't know the right way to do things, and yet they are very creative. For they came up with many, many innovations. So after addressing the demand, creating a demand and addressing the supply side, it was necessary to create this critical mass of people to use toilets. And that's where we started combining festivities with sanitation. And at this point, in 2011, I also discovered by this time that there was a World Toilet Day. So it was put under the World Toilet Day festivities, giving it somewhat more legitimacy as the entire world was supposed to be celebrating the toilet. And we started combining it with events for children, with events of beautification of public spaces, with opening our specialty toilets, which is the ecological toilets, urine diverting dry toilets. And still it wasn't enough, because to get this movement of change from top to bottom, it is really necessary to educate. That's how the third mission of Finn developed. Okay, the second being to share our learnings with the academic community. The third became to train all stakeholders in sustainability, notions of sustainability, circularity, safety, empathy, to create safe toilets. Because we feel still there are millions of toilets, ill-constructed toilets, that are going to contribute to points of contamination in the future. So we started these fun workshops. We developed a workshop notion, and this was actually implemented by volunteers in different parts of the world. So I was very happy to see, how it was giving rise to ideas in different parts of the world, including the developed world. And we also started reaching out to experts, because by this time, there were so many people working on innovation and behavioral change. So we have had some excellent webinars also. So now you see, we are doing a multitude of activities. It is no longer a celebration, it is a festival. And even this year, under the pandemic, because we are just getting out, we have had a variety of quiz contests held in different parts of the world, as well as this webinar on behavioral change, for which I'd like to welcome all of you and thank you for coming.
Can I please ask the panelists to Mr. Subbaraman, is there, Ellen, Mr. Lowens? He's there. If he can show his, great. Okay. So thank you so much for being with us first, and also Amrita. You see, due to problems of sanitation, even at the city level, there's been flooding in this city where I'm speaking from, Chennai, and the sewage water has got mixed with the drinking water. And a lot of people are sick, including the Indian student who was supposed to be with us, which makes it not only something theoretical, but something very practical, a practical problem. So my first question to the panelists is, you know, with respect to sanitation, there are many different kinds of problems. First, to build the toilets, to maintain the toilets, to make people use them, to find the money to build them, many, many problems. So I would like to know, in your view, in your country, which is the biggest problem that should be addressed today? So I'm just going, I'll go by alphabetical order of countries. So let me start with Ghana, and then come to India, and then come to Ireland. Is that okay?
Okay. Yes, that is fine.
So Mr. Lowens, you know, what is the biggest problem in Ghana with respect to sanitation, according to you? Which part, which damage?
Thank you very much. In Ghana, about open defecation is almost about 17% of the population. And one of the biggest challenges that the government is trying to address is access to household toilets by in local communities. And one of the key challenges also with this, as you already just mentioned, that sanitation problems bring about mixing of sewage water with the flooding waters, and sometimes Accra also get flooded. So one of the key initiatives we're trying to do is to promote on-site treatment with biodigesters. And with biodigesters, there is an innovative way in which the sewage, we set up small systems for households that they have on-site treatment. So we are advocating for government to transition all septic tanks into biodigesters. The biodigester is a simple technology which is attached to the superstructure of the toilet that helps with treatment of the sewage, and then generating gas from it, at the same time providing effluents that could be used for fertilizer application. And getting each household to get access to toilets is one of the key challenges that government is addressing, and also helping to improve access to on-site treatment is one of the other key challenges that government is addressing in Ghana.
So two things, to make toilets for everybody, okay?
Exactly.
So, and to make sure that you can treat the fecal sludge, that's what you're saying.
Exactly.
So we'll come back to you on this question. We have got 15 minutes per question. So let me move over to Mr. Subbaraman now. What is the biggest problem in India with respect to sanitation?
Good evening, everybody. Actually, the problem in India is they are not constructing proper toilet. They are not following the norms of the toilet. Any toilet have some noise, or all the toilets. Norms are there. They are not following any norms. They are constructing toilet. Mostly, they are constructing septic tank. It is not a septic tank. It is a collection tank. Like that, they don't know the technical options. They don't know even till now. That is the biggest problem. Then another problem is in the toilet usage. Many people constructing this leach pit toilet, but they are not using the toilet, many people. Even though India is in Tamil Nadu, already they declared ODL, but still the open defecation is there. Second one. Third one is the community toilet, women sanitary complex, all are not maintaining properly the community toilet. The maintenance is very, very poor. And in some places, there is no water. That's why they are not using the toilet. So that's why I am insisting the location-specific toilet. In this location, what type of toilet can construct? It will be useful for the people. It is a user-friendly toilet. Like that, we should insist them and construct a toilet. Mostly, I am preferring ecological sanitation, but still it is not moving fast. This is the only toilet model not contaminating anything, and also reusing the human waste, urine, and the fecal matter compost. So no problem, but people are not listening the benefit of the EcoSan toilet. So overall problem is many people, they don't know about the future thing. Always what is the sustainability? What is the sustainable one? There is no some, what is the tolainoku?
Sure.
What is the tolainoku, madam?
There is no sustainable model. I mean, but what you're saying, the problem in India is that there is a problem of how to construct. That means labor which is qualified to construct. And maybe we will come back to this again. It's in
that is a
recyclable one.
It's very true. The engineers, they don't know how to construct toilet. Masons also don't know how to construct a toilet. And the family members also don't know what is the type of toilet and all those things. Anyway, they are constructing a toilet, that's all. They are using toilet. Many people, they are using the toilet, but the treatment system, what treatment system we are following, they don't know.
That's the thing. So then I will come back to you and Mr. Lewins, because he hasn't mentioned the training of masons, and I'm wondering how Ghana is taking this. But first we move to Ireland. What is the problem of sanitation with respect to sanitation in Ireland? And how does it differ, you know, in some ways? What are the similarities? What are the differences with respect to what you have heard about Ghana and India?
So open defecation isn't really an issue here. It was a little bit over the summer because of COVID restrictions. People were wild camping. And if they weren't used to wild camping, they didn't know what to do for a bathroom. And there was this was on the paper. They were talking about it, saying this is unacceptable. So it's not really something that is done. The problem we have here is we're spoiled with really good toilets, really good systems, and they're just not being used properly. So the UN's title today for World Toilet Day is respect for valuing your toilet. And that's what we were looking at, where I'm working, was telling people we have this toilet. They're everywhere. They work really well. We either have an urban system or a septic tank. People complain about them. They're very, very good. But the problem we have is people using things like wipes. So it's a wipe here, packet there. So these are baby wipes. There is a sign on it to say don't flush it down the toilet, but the sign's not very clear. And as someone was saying to me, when you've opened the packet and you're trying to clean a dirty bum of a baby, you're not reading the packet. So in a lot of the Western world, and very much in Ireland, we live very convenience lifestyles, and the convenience products that have been here since possibly the mid 90s, wipes for cleaning houses, wipes for cleaning babies, wipes for kind of cleaning any surface, wipes for taking off your makeup. They're quick and they're easy. Because they look like a moist toilet paper, people throw them in the toilets. When they're thrown in the toilets, they can cause a number of problems. They can block the toilet at source, which means you have a blocked toilet. Nobody wants that. They can make their way to the wastewater treatment center, and they can actually get entangled in the machinery. The machinery has to get shut down. This costs time and money. And really, it's taxpayers' money that's going into these, so we want them to work as quickly as possible. The other problem is they have plastic in them. They can make their way through the wastewater treatment plant into lakes, the rivers and the ocean, all the time letting small bits of plastic out. This affects the marine life and the water quality. Fish are obviously drinking this water. When we're eating the fish, we're ingesting that plastic that we've put into the system, and they get washed up on beaches, which is a problem obviously for land mammals who might mistake them for food. There's plastic being leached out. Ireland's a very small country, so even the fact that our coastline are small, and our coastline is kind of near everybody, so it's very easy to get to the beach. Tourism is incredibly important, and people don't want to see these wipes on the beach. So there's a number of issues with them. Wipes aren't the only one. They're kind of the main one, but like dental floss, hair, cotton bud sticks, contact lenses. Again, these are all fairly modern convenience products that here people throw down the toilet.
So this is, it's very interesting that at the base, one of the things being talked about is education. Mr. Subbaraman is talking about education from the supply side of the masons in the labor market. And you are talking, and he's also mentioning families, and you are talking about toilets from the consumer side, you know, the people who are using it. So I want to link up the technology to the entire place of the toilet in society. Okay, so I want to link it up to a second question now. Mr. Lowen, since you are saying, first there are two questions. How is the biogas toilet? What are the differences with, you know, what are the advantages and disadvantages with respect to the urine diverting dry toilet, number one? And if you feel that the biogas toilet is the best technology for urban developing countries, okay, what is the stakeholder you are targeting to make sure that
this is
being diffused? Yeah.
I should say that the urine separation toilets might be an enhancement when you are using, you want to also separate the urine and collect it for fertilization. However, the biogas toilets are climate smart toilet facilities that actually address a number of challenges. One, normally you poop and forget about it, but with this one, when you poop, the toilet is being digested and it can produce gas, methane gas that can be used for cooking in households. So if you look at it in schools, it's used in schools, it's used in households, especially in Ghana, the household is like, and not only the father, son, and children, but household sizes are bigger, especially in the local communities. So when they use the biogas digester, the differences with this one, the biogas digester provide opportunity for on-site treatment. For example, in Ghana, and whilst the urine separation toilet, still you may have to take the toilet and dislodge it somewhere else. All right. In Ghana, for example, there is a very popular community called the Lavender Hill. And it's Lavender Hill because almost all the Greater Accra regional septic tanks that are taken dislodged from the households and schools are lodged on into the sea, seashore, close to the community in a lagoon. And that place smells so bad that they call the place Lavender Hill. And the solution to that was that the government, in partnership with the private sector organization.
So Lavender Hills is where all the sludge is thrown out in Accra. Yes. Whom do you target to make sure everyone has a biogas? How are you going to, what is your target? Whom do you target?
So we provide a multifaceted customer target.
And then so from the policy level, you target the customer. You want people to buy your toilets.
Exactly.
Okay.
On the one hand, we target customers to educate them through the media and on face and open door meetings, town hall meetings, to explain the benefits of a biogas digester over the other septic tank enabled toilets. And most people now sign up that they want the biodigesters. Now we are also advocating government at the policy level through the Biogas Association of Ghana to encourage more the government to put in regulations so that every household and every schools or institutions that or public institutions take set example by switching to biogas toilets. So this is a very big opportunity that is promoting and addressing access to biogas toilet facilities in Ghana. And now the market is open and investments are flowing into the country around this.
But okay. No, this is very good because this means that this is a what we call a typical innovation, introducing an innovation into the market. But because the toilet is can also serve, it has a social value, you are not only pursuing the business pathway, you're also trying to get the governments to give subsidies maybe for biogas toilet. Okay, now then I move to Mr. Subbaraman to make sure to address your problem. Your problems that you mentioned where everybody needs to learn. First, masons need to learn, but engineers maybe need to learn. Then you said engineers need to learn, politicians need to learn, families need to learn. So whom are you going to teach? Where do you start? It seems to be, you know, like a thousand-headed problem.
At the grassroots level, first you have to motivate the people, householders. Then slowly, then we can go up like panchayat president, then block development office, then collector, then the state government secretary. Like that we can create models and slowly we have to take it and spread it all over the country like that.
Okay. So
at the same time, we can give training to the masons and engineers also. Those who are using the for the overseers, engineers, the block level, they should also know the benefit of the ecological sanitation And again, at the same time, the urine diversion flush toilet connected to the biogas plant. That is very good model. And now the gas cost is more now, increasing, every day increasing. So we have to make our waste, to put it there inside our human waste or kitchen waste or cow dung, then get gas free of cost, not necessary LPG gas. And also safety, this is very, very, very safety one. So these are all to motivate the people. That is the main
So goal. you are going to buy a biogas unit from Mr. Lovens, because yes. You are saying that this one. So Mr. Lovens, you've got a new customer here in India, but I think there are a lot of biogas units. We will come back to this technology, but I just have one last curiosity question for Mr. Subbaraman. There are so many training programs in India, okay, for masons, for engineers, with all this. So what do you think about these programs?
They are not giving importance. The sanitation is the secondary one, third one, like that. There people are thinking, and the government is also thinking like that. It is a priority one. Sanitation is a priority one.
Okay.
Toilet is a must for particularly women, children, and aged person also, even handicapped.
Yes, I can hear you.
So what you are saying is they're not teaching it well because they don't care. Yeah. I got it. Now, that I agree with you. I think that there must be something wrong somewhere. Dr. Amrita, we'll just come back when we get the questioning session. You will have the full floor. Okay. I'm just going to Ellen now to give. Whom do you target? Because, you know, you can ask should the government put fines? Should the community pay? Who should pay and for the damage cost? So whom are you targeting?
So initially we set out to kind of target everybody because everybody uses a toilet. And we've done a bit of research and we found that it's mainly over 18s under 35s, living in their own homes and months. So these are the people, often parents of small kids, so it mightn't always be them throwing the things in the toilet, or these are the people that are very busy, so using these products. While we do target older people, we found that over 55s, but mainly a lot older than that, they wouldn't have... We kind of target everybody, but we'd found that it was, from the research we've done, it was between the ages of 18 and 35 were the most likely to flush things like wipes down the toilet. And we found that it's people living, while we try and target everybody, yeah, we'd found it was the 18 to 35s were the most likely to flush the unsuitable items.
Okay. The thing is, Amrita, did you have any question? I was told that you had raised your hands. Did you have a clarificatory question?
Yes, I was just wanted to ask Mr. Subramaniam about what he was saying, Subbaraman sir, that he was saying that actually it's the engineers or the masons who are not able to make good toilets which are, helpful. But I was curious to know that have they adopted this biogas model as well? What's exactly the problem in actually what should be the ideal toilet that should be built that would be better for India's circumstances and where he's working? So that's the clarification I wanted to have from him.
For me, this is a debate question, not a clarificatory question. So if you don't mind, we'll finish the three questions and then we will have the debate. Okay, because this needs more time. But Mr. Subbaraman, this is a very good question she has asked. Okay, it's $1 million question, and I would like to know which toilet is better for even Ireland, because, I'd like to know. I'm curious. So what's the best model? So we'll just come back to that. I would just like to come to my last question, because I want to understand how you work to achieve your goals, the sanitation goals. So I request each of the panelists to give me one success story and one failure story, and try to kind of help us understand through your story exactly what led to the success or what led to the failure. You know, and in both, there could be things outside of your control. So, Mr. Lumens, let's have a round of success stories first, three success stories. The floor is yours, Mr. Lumens, for a success story.
Yes. So, can you hear me?
Yes.
Good. One of the very good success stories that we have had was that people, biogas digesters were perceived as big, and the need for it to replace septic tanks was a big challenge. So we have been doing research and trying to find out solutions, and then they came up with a biofuel toilet. But then we have been able to, on the one hand, one of the success stories that we have been able to model the biogas digester into a smaller piece, just like one and half sides of a tabletop. And this toilet is called, we're using the anaerobic baffled reactor technology to modify it so that biogas digesters become smaller and it can fit onto this kind of pictures that you showed with one toilet facility. You can have this kind of biogas digesters in each household, and more households now, with that research and innovation, now every household is able to get a smaller septic tank-like biogas digesters that is also very efficient because it treats the waste completely, and whatever comes out is totally just water that goes, that is very clean, that goes into the drain. And that is one of the key things that has been our successes, that we are now, it is now helping most households in Ghana to adopt and use biogas digesters. And I think that will be another initiative that we can be transferred to other countries to ensure access to sustainable toilets for many households, especially in poor rural areas. Just to touch one more on also financing, government also brought in an initiative to promote such biodigesters toilets for households by providing incentives. So currently government is providing about 60% incentives, and households are able to provide just 40% to have a toilet, especially in the Greater Accra and then the Kumasi, which is also the most populated urban areas where people access to toilet facilities are very difficult per population. Thank you.
So I see that your success is driven by really your technology design, the innovativeness of your technology design. Now, how many units have you sold so far?
So far, with the innovation that came up, and of course, this also went with a lot with education and awareness. We over 5,000 of these biofuel digesters kind of toilets have been deployed in the local communities in Ghana, and especially in the urban slum communities. And even poor households are being able to have access to the toilets now.
And what is the oldest of the biogas units that you have put? I mean, how many years does this represent, this 5,000?
For the initiative has started almost about 7 years ago. And so oldest toilets at that smaller scale, it's about 7 years now.
Very good. Very excellent. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Mr. Subbaraman, what is your success story that made you happy? That what are you happy about? What is your success story? Of course, everyone knows you've got the highest award from the Indian government, so you'll have many successes. Out of all the successes, which one do you like best?
Actually, in all the locations, the best toilet model is ecological sanitation, moving diversion, dehydration, toilet. Any place, any location, it is possible. It is a good model, no problem. The success story is the first toilet I have constructed in Musri block, one of the village, Kaliapalayam. In that village, they started constructing toilet, but within a few, 1 feet, the water level is there when they dig the pit. So I am educating the people to construct different type of toilet. This is a good model, ecological sanitation. It's a good model. This is constructing above the ground level, so it's no problem and easy to maintenance all these things. Then I have taken that Mangalathammal, one of the self-help group member, Mangalathammal. She is an uneducated woman, but she is very positive action in the ecological sanitation. We constructed that one in the first toilet, and also the secretary, the rural development secretary, Madam Sandachila Nair, also came there for inaugurate the first toilet. So people are thinking, why even a thing, household toilet is inaugurated by the secretary? So that much of importance the other people are understand. And the new toilet constructed in Kaliapalayam village in 1983.
So I see that your success
2003.
Very good. Your success is having got even the very high level policy makers to understand the value of EcoSan toilets. I mean, from the poorest to the highest. Yes, that is a great achievement, because that is the first step to understanding. Elaine, what is your success story?
So I know you had told us not to talk about statistics, but we had known from our statistics that less people are saying they are flushing unsuitable items down the toilet. But one group I had thought of and that we don't usually work with was teenagers, because they're not one of the demographics that was coming up in our statistics to work with. But we were doing a project, we were at an event called Seminar for Generation Z. This is a few years ago. And these kids aren't using makeup wipes like I was using at their age. And it came up about cigarettes. So I was saying, you know you're not meant to smoke, but I'm not going to lecture you on that. You know you're not meant to do it. But we also have to acknowledge, if something's being done, instead of just telling people not to do it, we have to tell them how to dispose of it properly and then consider not doing it. So the kids were saying to me, cigarette butts. Can you not flush those? So I said, there's two major reasons. They don't flush. They said, when your parents come into the bathroom, they're going to see the cigarette and then you're going to get in trouble. And I said, the second problem is the filter part of a cigarette. The person doesn't smoke that. That's the worst part. And then that is going into the toilet. So I said, that's all these toxins that you didn't want to put in your own body now going into the water system, making its way into the fish that we're eating, into the marine species, into the water that we're getting out the tap. And I was saying, while you think you're doing the right thing, because no one wants to throw their cigarette into the grass because they're worried about catching fire, it's thought in this part of the world, well, the toilet is just like a bin and it's waste and it'll get rid of it. You know, someone will get rid of it without realizing that all these pipes are connected. So I said to the students, I'm not going to ask you if you smoke. That's not up to me. But I said, just know not to do that. And if you need to smoke, find another way to dispose of it. So I could see by their faces, they were listening and they had got quite a shock, because if these kids are smoking, that's one issue, but they're not doing it to contaminate water. That's not what they're doing it for. And kids are conscientious. So just when they're thinking that what they do could impact others in that really negative way, it did get them thinking. So out of the number of success stories that I had in my head, that was one of the ones that kind of came strongest to mind.
This is very interesting, because teenagers are the most stubborn lot. I think, I don't know, maybe with senior citizens, I don't know which is the most. but still, this is the strategy of communication matters. Okay, I see that. Now, I also know that we have only about 20 minutes left. So what I want to ask is, I want to take my powers as a panel coordinator to say, can the students want to ask questions, ask them, and can you please, if possible, in the answers, hit upon, tell about your failure stories, because we don't have time to do another, we don't have time to do another round of panel stories. So let's throw the floor open, and we can start perhaps with Amrita's question. What is your dream toilet technology design for sustainability? And then, I mean, anyone else can go ahead. Amrita, am I summarizing your question so that everyone can talk about their dream design?
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you. Thank you for summarizing.
We will go in the same round, Ghana, India.
Can I so go first?
Yes. But everybody try to be brief so that we Very can brief. Have the maximum questions. Yeah.
Wonderful. So my dream toilet facility is that every household has a toilet on which there is on-site treatment. And not only that, but then they are able to harness the toilet, the gases from the toilet through a biodigester for cooking and heating in order to reduce their energy expenditure. And at the same time, the effluent to help with household gardening, because it is very rich in soil fertility. And that will address climate change, address open dislodging of toilets in seas and waters, and ensure a healthy environment. But those one of the biggest challenges that we found in deploying the biodigester that called for a lot of maintenance and training and awareness education was just what is happening in Alice's place, where they have to sometimes put the, especially in where ladies are, they put the pads, they put the toilet rolls inside the toilet, and then at the end of the day, it gets choked and maintenance become a challenge. So that is one of the key challenges we have, and it calls for quite a lot of maintenance when the toilet facilities are. So we educate people and we provide waste disposal buckets close there. By that, that can automatically close and is cleaned by the toilet, so that all those weights and stuff are carried and taken to a different place for treatment, while the organic waste is treated straight away in the biogas digesters. Thank you.
That's good. So it's even an improved design where maintenance will be very automatic. That's your dream toilet. Okay.
That's right.
Mr. Subbaraman, your dream toilet?
The design of the ecological sanitation. Lately, we have modified through IIT Delhi. What is the difficulties faced by the people are telling to others? The first defecate, then move back and put ash or sawdust or soil and close it, then wash your body. They are not willing to move back, because open defecation, they are moving front, and the eco-thin toilet, they are moving back and wash. And they are not willing like that. That's why even I have been to China, and I have seen the toilet models, Ecosound toilet models, Western type, and they sit the bowl open, then defecate, and they have wipers. So they wipe it and put it inside and stand all these stone back, then all the fecal matter and the paper all goes down. Like that, in Indian type also, IIT Delhi people, they designed accordingly, put a defecate, then if you press the lever, then the close in, then wash your body, that water goes separately. So no problem. Like that have designed already, they modified the design. The user-friendly Ecosun toilet model is available now. No problem.
So you say that the user-friendly Ecosun model as a decentralized toilet is the best model, and that's a model for India.
Yes.
Thank you. I have many questions on that, but not now, because the maintenance is again a problem. Now, Elaine, what is your dream toilet to address the problem of not making people put things into the toilet?
I never thought about this, but really, I would say the system we have is very good, and it's just people are not using it properly. So I don't believe in adding in more technology. Like some people say, we should have no wipes, or we should have a better system to break down the wipes. That's not needed. That's too complicated, because something else will get invented and it won't be able, the system won't deal with that. It's if people use the system properly, there won't be a need for anything else. But I do remember being in Australia years ago, and they had compostable toilets, and because Australia is so big, everything was dealt with on site. So where I live, because I live in the countryside, we do have a septic tank in our own home. I do think that's different than if you live in an urban area, because you don't have to think. If the system breaks down, it's somebody's job to take care of it. And I think that disconnection from understanding how the toilet works is probably, it happens in urban areas anyway, because not everywhere can have an on-site system. But I suppose on-site systems I find great. If there was a better way maybe of using less water, that would be one big one. The Western toilet uses 10 litres of water with every flush, which is a lot. But really, my thing would be personal responsibility and making use of a good system that we already have.
That's good. So it's not the technology design, but the mindset. I now give the floor to Amrita, because I'm very curious to know what behavioral economics has to, you know, what insight it gives on everything that's been said. And also generally, Amrita, the economics of innovation and market introduction of innovation. Here, it's more than just the business in innovation. It's really something to make the world a cleaner place. So absolutely, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And thank you to Mr. Lovans, Mr. Subbaraman, and Ms. Doyle. It was nice knowing your stories. Now, I will start with the Ireland story. That's one of the first and the easiest one. So let me start with that one, because it's clearly a behavioral change that we are looking towards. Because according to what she has told us, shared with us, the current Western toilet system that they have is perfectly well functioning. And it's not the same story with how what we have in Ghana and India. So the basic characteristics that people like to be able to change their behavior, the first thing they need to change is their attitude, then their behavioral beliefs. Yeah, and they need to be able to evaluate what will entail when they change their behavior. Why would they do it? What they have to gain out of it? And then the subjective ones. For us, an example, while listening to her, I got to know a lot of things that I am not supposed to flush. I didn't know that I am not supposed to flush here, right? So this is the thing. The information, absence of information is one of the biggest reason I think the problems they are facing. That you're not supposed to flush your wipes. You're not supposed to put in any other thing. So these things, as the funny story she also shared with us, about the cigarette butts, the students didn't know that they're not supposed to do it. So information's gap are there, I guess. And I'm sure if that can be addressed, and that is a very interesting place where the nudge theory actually can be applied. Because if you inform people, tell them, let them know, so these are the things you're not supposed to flush, then how to get rid of those things? It's a matter of having another extra toilet, toilet basket or with your basket in your bathroom so that you can put the wipes therein. So that's it can be actually the information, making people actually aware of the things would be really helpful, I think. I guess she will agree agree with me. But when I was listening to the story of Ghana and India, oh my God. Well, but it gave me hope. Because the when we are talking about biogas and actually creating methane that people can actually use for cooking in their house, so there is a market. And then the economist mini is like, okay, we can marketize. A government can actually give them subsidies, of course, as you asked, Mr. Lohans. So subsidizing the model, giving and making people aware, okay, this is the amount of money you will be able to save. Because nowadays we know gas has become really costly. And I'm talking from India for sure. So if you save money, in the way we actually save money, if we put up solar panels, that can be used. And it's a completely competitive market structure that we can come up with that will be able to help. So that's there is hope there. But I am India, once again, coming to India. It's very, very difficult. In India, I think the problem we have, it's called status quo bias. The people don't want to change their behavior because they have some societal norms and hangover with the practices. They have really weird beliefs regarding how to use toilets, what to do with them, whether to use them or not. So that's a huge problem. And though a lot of tools and measurement has been taken by Indian government, this Swachh Bharat mission was one of those to make people aware, give people subsidies to make toilets. That was there. But definitely, as Mr. Subbaraman shared, that this also I wasn't aware of. Okay, the problem lies with the engineers and the masons. That has to be really like implemented in the policy level and has to be changed by the government. And then, of course, people has to be, for as an example, in one of our interaction, you let us know that this toilet, there was this contest of beautiful toilet beautification. So be a best looking toilets, best built toilets can be given award. These are the kind of activities we can take to necessitate and facilitate changes. But of course, it will take time and more people like Mr. Subbaraman can actually help people come up with alternative practices. But I was listening to this EcoSan toilet and how you can actually use it. That's a very beautiful thing. But I'm sure there, as ma'am was telling us, that there might be some problem regarding the feasibility and of usage. But this is a bigger problem and it needs more nudges and it needs, giving people subsidies to actually incorporate these changes. So this, then I guess any behavioral change can be facilitated through four steps: action, target, contextualization, and time. Right. So we have to, what we are targeting to get, that we have to be clear about it. Then what action needs to be taken, create the context in the society and the culture, and of course, timely implementation of the project and the change has to be done. So I think that sums up the problems we have and how we can actually change it and facilitate change, behavioral changes. Hopefully
To summarize, what I see is that there's a lot of work. There are two kinds of solutions, three pathways. One is the market pathway.
Absolutely.
That is the Ghanaian. That would be the easiest, because if people realize that they can have an economic return, that will be good. The second pathway is education at all levels, and Ellen, there are many, third social sector entities with bottom-up initiatives. To have education at the supply side at all levels, the government has to play in. So it looks as though everybody has a role to play in order to achieve this sustainable development goal. It's not anybody wants any one economic actor's responsibility alone. So with this, I will stop. I think we have had a very good discussion, and I will ask Raja and Emma to give the vote of thanks to close up.
And in due course, and hope to keep the engagement, with this, I would call ourselves as a community, this community.
Yes.
And in thanking everyone who made this happen would first like to start with the organizers who did the day-to-day grunt work, Abhishek, Akshita, and later today also Anurag, and of course Shama for driving this. I want to very much thank our partners, Engineers Without Borders and NCAD, John, Emma, Elaine, and their teams who had made this happen. The speakers, Ms. Lohan, Mr. Subbaraman, Amrita, it really gave a tremendous perspective ranging from EcoSan, which I thought I had kind of, I think, Shama, I was thinking that it is something which only we are talking about, but is glad to see that other people are also, you know, it's beyond us and Kameshwaram, and that it is part of the agenda, and also biodigesters, as well as understanding that even in a relatively more developed country like Ireland, they are still continuing and sharing that they also have challenges, which means that even as we develop, we will continue to have a different set of challenges in behavioral change. Then, while not directly discussed here today, I want to take this occasion to also thank all the quiz masters who anchored and helped holding quizzes all over, I mean, various countries. Shama, you may have to help me here, but I believe Paramjyoti, Monish over here, and Sarah, and I think Elaine again, right? So a double thanks to her for her participation. And Shama, thanks to the FinTrust team and everyone who participated, and you for anchoring and moderating and driving to make this event possible. Let us build on this, and I'm excited in the build-up to this, how we have started a dialogue with Engineers for Borders to look at certain sanitation prototypes. I hope it finds more fruit and is given added impetus from this joint event. Thank you.
Thank you.
Emma, over to you.
Thanks very much, Raja. Yeah, I think you've given a great summary of it there. And I think certainly just to echo what you were saying around Let's Left, definitely keep the conversation going. And I think there's so much learning that we can take from each other. And, you know, Tomás touched on a really important point that, you know, what can we learn here in Ireland about how to make our systems more, our sanitation systems more efficient? They work well, as Elaine said, but they can, you know, certainly be improved in terms of water use efficiency. And so I think there's a lot of learning that we can take from India and Ghana in terms of implementation that you guys are doing. But yeah, otherwise, just to thank again, I think Tomás is still on the call. Thanks so much for joining, Tomás, and your contribution and questions, and for the great video from you guys at NCAD. And to everyone, thank you for your time, and we look forward to keeping the conversation going.
Right.
Thank you very much. Thank you again.
Hello, I am Abhishek Pathak from Ranchi, Jharkhand, and currently Junior Manager at Friend in Need India Trust, and also part of organizing team of World Toilet Day. For World Toilet Day, I am creating content and also doing other organizing activities. I am blessed to be the part of World Toilet Day organizing team, because World Toilet Day help us to learn about sanitation, sustainability, behavioral change, safety, and empathy. Thank you so much.
Hello, I am Akshita Kapoor, a BTech second year student. For this World Toilet Day event, I was part of the organizing team. This event has helped me gain experience in so many ways. Through this event, I was able to learn new things and was able to explore with myself. I cannot thank much Friend in Need India for this wonderful opportunity.